Hey, it's John at Enduring Charm. This is a pair of louvered shutters off of a house, and there are another 20 pairs of these shutters on the rest of the house. So this is just the first set, and as you can probably already see, they need some help. Aside from needing repainting, there's definitely some damage here that you can see. The wood has been exposed. This is a southern exposure for these shutters, and it's been exposed to that UV radiation for many years, and the wood has just deteriorated quite a bit. Now the shutters on the opposite side of the house aren't quite so bad because they've been shaded for a lot of their life, but these in the back with the direct sunlight really took a beating. So in this video I'm going to be doing more than just sanding and repainting. We need to actually do some repairs to these areas right here. So this is the top of one of the shutters. And this end grain right here, you can see there's a lot of checks in there, not good. So water is getting in there and it will just continue to deteriorate and eventually just rot away. So we need to do something about that. Now, if we look carefully at the construction here, you can see they were well made originally. These are pegged mortise and tenon construction. So this cross piece right here, which is known as a rail, fits into this style here, and there's a tenon from this rail into this style, and then you can see there's some dowels that were inserted here. Those are the pegs. So the tenon fits in here, they are pegged in place, so it really can't come apart. However, as the wood deteriorates like this, that poses a problem and the joint is going to fail. The louvers here I can see were also mortised in place. That looks pretty good. I don't see any rot here. This all looks like it's held up pretty well. It needs painting for sure, and sanding, and maybe some scraping, but other than that, it's in good shape. It's mostly these joints here where the wood has just deteriorated. Now, there's a bead profile right here, so when I do some sanding, I have to be careful. I can't just go sand willy-nilly because I could remove that bead profile or destroy that bead profile, so I have to be careful about how much sanding I actually do. Of course, the hardware needs some help too, so I can remove this and sand it down and paint it, but let me turn this shutter over now and show you the hardware on the other side, because these are hinged by this piece of hardware right here. So if we turn this over, you can see this hinge includes a bracket, an L bracket, which does help keep this all together. Now, this does need some paint. I have two choices here. I could actually leave it in place, in other words, not remove it, and sand it down and then paint the black part first and then the green part later, or I could take them off and address it that way. I'll have to see which I prefer, and that decision will come down to whether removing this will cause more harm than good as far as the joint itself. You can see on the back side here, the wood is in much better shape. You don't see the checking a little bit here, but not too bad that you see on the other side. And that's because this side was shaded. Normally these are kept open and the sun just doesn't shine on the back of the shutter here, so the wood is in better condition. So my first step is going to be just to do a light sanding. Again, I don't want to go so far that I, you know, remove some of the detail here. I got to be careful about that. But I want to do a light sanding just to get, you know, the worst of this kind of scraped off, and then I can better see what I'm dealing with. All right, after a little bit of sanding, we can better see what's going on here. And, you know, it's not good, but I think we can fix this. So from what I can tell, these rails and stiles, the frame, in other words, is made of pine. I believe the louvers themselves may be made of fir. And, you know, in this case right here, this is a particularly bad one. You can see the checks go quite deep, and this is the top, so water's going to get in there. So one thing I could do is I could drill out these pegs and remove this style and replace it with a new one. That is a possibility. But the amount of work involved to do that, honestly, I'm almost halfway to making a new shutter, so it's probably not worth it. And remember, this is one pair. I have another 20 pair to go. So I got to be careful about the budget here. So I am going to have to keep in place what I see here. I believe none of the shutters are any worse than this. So if I can make it work on this first set here, then I can make it work on all of them. So I need a solution not just to fill these cracks for aesthetic purposes, but also to hold this wood together. And, you know, there are a number of ways I might do that. Now, you see me use products like this before. You have the Minwax wood hardener, which kind of penetrates into the wood. And if the wood's a little punky, it'll help consolidate it. And then you can use what is basically Bondo filler. Now, this can work in many circumstances. You see me use it before, but in this circumstance, I'm not big on the idea. For one thing, because there's going to be a lot of expansion contraction in that wood, and there's going to be a tendency for this filler to kind of fall out over time. It won't adhere to the wood very well, and over time, it'll just come apart. So that's really not going to be my solution. Instead, I'm going to use this West System Epoxy. Now, this is an old brand. It's been around many years, very popular with woodworkers and people who do repairs on old houses. So this two-part system, you have to mix the epoxy in a certain ratio. And what I've done is purchased these pumps that go on the bottles themselves. So you have this one and this one. And the beauty is you have one pump and one pump from each can, and it's the perfect ratio. So it is a little more expensive to buy these pumps, but they are well worth it. I'll try to put a link in the comments. So I'll mix these, and you can do as many pumps as you need in order to fill the space that you need. But this system, this epoxy, is fairly liquid in its consistency, so it's going to flow out of those cracks. What I need to do is add this filler. And I'll show you how this all works. And I'm using the 403 microfiber filler. This will make the epoxy much thicker so I can apply it and it will stay put. Now, the advantage of this epoxy is severalfold. For one thing, it will act as a glue to keep that wood together. And even as the wood expands and contracts, this will hold tenaciously to that wood. It will actually soak in a little bit and form just a very tenacious bond. It's also waterproof, so as it soaks into the wood, it provides sort of a barrier for further deterioration over time. Now, after I apply this and let it cure, then I will have to sand again. So I only did one light sanding. After I've applied this and made all the cracks whole again, then I need to do a much more thorough sanding. Now, I like to do this process in two steps. I'm just going to use a solo cup or anything like that is fine to mix up the epoxy. So the first thing I'm going to do is mix just the epoxy, not with a filler, and it will be a very liquid consistency. Then I'll use just a disposable brush like this, and I will just force that epoxy into all those cracks and make sure that liquid gets in there deeply. I want a nice bond with that wood. Once I do that, then I will come back and I will add the filler to the epoxy. I'll probably have to make some more. And then I'll just use, you could use a putty knife, or a lot of times I'll just use a shim like this. And this is going to be a much thicker consistency. I can use this to force it into the cracks, but there's already some liquid in that crack, which is soaking into the wood. So that two-part process, if you will, allows just a very thorough bond. All right, I've mixed this up very thoroughly, just in its liquid form now. So now I can take this brush and just force it in the cracks and make sure I get liquid in all those little areas that if this were thicker, it might not get in. But by having it in this liquid form, I can make sure I get in there. Here's a little knot. So I just want to make sure I get very good penetration. And because the cure time is a little bit longer on this, this is fine. I can leave this step, go back and add some filler, and then come back, and this will still be damp. All right, I'm getting a little bit low on the epoxy, so I'm going to add a few more squirts, and then we'll talk about the filler. All right, this filler comes in a powder form, and it's just a thickener. It's almost like flour when you're baking, in a way. And you can just take your hands and just start adding in. The mixture isn't super critical. It's really just adding a bunch. And then I'll mix it up and just see if I like the consistency or not. That's already getting thicker, but I want a little bit more. That's better, but I still want a little thicker yet, so let me add some more. Now we're getting close to what I need. Now I do need to do a little bit more mixing, but that's pretty close. All right, now that I've got my thicker mixture, Remember, I've already kind of prepped or primed this with the more liquid version. I could take a wooden shim here, and that's what I'm dealing with. So even it will roll off the shim, but not very easily. Now I can take this and force it into the joints. And this is going to act as a filler so we don't see the cracks after we paint. Now it's still pretty sloppy, but I'll smooth it out as best I can. And it will sand fairly easily when it cures. So here's a close-up of one of the ends, and you can see with that thicker consistency, I can use this as a filler. It will fill those heavy checks and cracks, and I'll sand it down flush later. This one over here, that one was very bad, but you can see it sticks in there and it won't flow out. So we just need to let this cure now. Now, if you are curious about cure times, you can get different hardeners that will extend the cure time. But I think for most people, you'll probably stick with the 205, which is the fastest one. All right, so I let this dry overnight. This is what we're left with in the morning. And like I said, probably about 8 hours is all you needed to wait, but I just waited overnight. I just brought these shutters into the shop, and in this case, I've noticed that there's some actual rot. I don't know if you can see that, but I can actually put my finger right in there. It's very soft. So this is no good, and how deep it goes, we'll see. So my choice may be to remove the style and put a new one in. However, if the rot doesn't go too far, you can cut out the rot, use the epoxy, and cut a filler piece of wood to fit in here as best you can, and then fill in around the sides of that with the epoxy. So that's another option. Now here's a good example of a patch where, you know, this whole area here was rotted, and I just cut out all the rotted material, inserted this little patch right here, and epoxied it in place, and that will be plenty strong. I don't even need mechanical fasteners. That will be plenty strong to hold this back together. And once this is painted, you'll never know that patch is there. But after a few minutes of sanding here, I'm going to try to give you some close-up examples. So this one was pretty badly checked, and with the belt sander on the bottom here, you can see most of that is gone. There might be a few divots there, and I can fix that easily enough. On the top here, you can see, you know, I've taken off quite a bit of the old paint and really down to bare wood in some sections. So I have some more sanding to do here, and then I can start on the painting process, and I have a lot of shutters to go. Most of the hardware I've removed, and I will wire brush that and paint it separately. Once you remove the rust and everything, it paints up pretty nicely. However, one half of the hinge I'm leaving on the shutters, in most cases anyway. You can see there's some surface rust and all, and I do need to take care of that. But if I try to remove all of these, some of these screws are going to snap off, and I may just get myself into more trouble than it's worth. So what I'm going to do is use a wire wheel on a drill. I'll clean this up. I may use some sandpaper as well. So I'll get all the rust off, and I can actually paint this hinge or half of the hinge in place with a spray can, get all that painted. Of course, I will get some on the wood as well, but that's fine. Once that's dry, then I can paint over the edges, and I can basically cut in with a brush, and it will look perfect, and it will be protected. Now let me go over a few details about painting. Preparation is key, of course. You notice this is still wet right here. That's because I just washed these with soap and water and a brush, and then just used a hose, a garden hose, to wash out some of the dirt. I don't use a pressure washer because I don't like how water can get forced into crevices, and that's not good for the paint job later. You can see the original primer was an oil-based. You see that lighter green color? That's an oil-based primer, and then they use latex over that, and it's held up well. However, we generally don't use oil-based primers anymore, and because I've used this West system, I would not want to use an oil-based primer over that. So there are some areas where there's bare wood, and I will want to prime that. Here's one example already where I did some gray primer there on top of what was there, and the latex primer will hold up better on top of that West system. You can also see where I sprayed the hinge here, and again, the spray went over, but it doesn't matter because all that's going to get covered. Now for the finish coats, I'm using this Benjamin Moore product. in the soft gloss, and the color is called Essex Green, and I'm pretty sure that's what was there originally. And I'll do two coats of this. Now, I know with these louvers, it's tempting to try to use a spray gun, but again, I'm not a big believer in spray guns, especially in situations like this, because I want to work that paint into every nook and cranny. So I'm just going to use a brush. It'll take a little bit longer, but that way I'm sure I'm getting very good coverage and good mechanical adhesion. And one quick little aside, you can see there's some staining here, that white stuff right there. Well, that's from a bat. It's very common for bats to hide behind the shutters. In fact, when I'm taking shutters off, it's very common for me to find a sleeping bat behind there. I usually put a glove on and put him in a tree, and he's not too happy about being woken up from his nap. But this stuff, the bat poop and the bat pee is not great for your health. So again, a good reason to wash this down with soap and water and just get rid of all that. All right, I got the first coat of paint on one side done and dry, I think, or just nearly dry. And so now I can start on the opposite side, which hasn't been touched yet. So this does take some time to paint correctly, but you know, that time is well spent. It could be another 25 years before these are painted again. So I want to make sure we do it right. With a little more investigation, I realized this shutter is gone. There's no way I'm going to be able to fix this. I might be able to save some of these louvers, but these main rails and stiles here are just gone. So I'm going to have to actually build a new shutter to replace this one.